Great. Well, I will very quickly try and wrap up some of these fantastically articulated and often quite detailed presentations by bringing in some of the discussions and themes, and I've actually got Mariana's authority to do this, that occurred. Nothing you've said unless you've got Mariana's authority, so I obviously took the liberty of checking, that occurred during the day so that we can kind of couch the broader discussion perhaps in that sense. But I thought I would just begin by kind of showing my sort of disappointment at the rather personal nature of the remarks from Ronald Dorr at the beginning, when he talked about the exponential growth of Pig Belly, which I know was aimed at me following 2 days of fine food in this environment, and it was only exacerbated and made worse when he talked about the doctrine of green being good, greed being good, as being the Greco philosophy, which, given my ethnic origins, I knew was a personal slight. Anyway, I'll write about all this sort of personal tomfoolery and move from my own palpable greed to that of bankers and corporations, where I feel much more comfortable. But I thought, you know, before we discuss where we go from here, I thought both Mary and Peter's discussion in particular touched on how we ended up where we are now. You know, we see the technology bubble. That may not have been a bad thing. What clearly was a bad thing was the more malevolent debt-fueled bubble, when you start getting bubbles in things like housing. My personal bugbear being the degree to which policymakers actually fueled some of those bubbles and imbalances. It's very difficult. I mean, leaving aside monetary policy and the expectation that it would always be eased when things get bad but not raised when they're good, governments tend to exacerbate cycles for very simple reasons. When you've got revenues flooding in because your asset prices are booming, it's very hard for you as an elected politician to start tightening policy, to sit on war chests of public surpluses. And so when I was at the Treasury, there was a lot of ex post rationalisation of why house prices were rising. That's demographics, it's supply and demand. Why should trade growth be higher than it's ever been so we can justify borrowing and spending? Well, because of the new economy, see, the productivity revolution in the US, but it hasn't hit the UK yet. Hey, yeah, but it will, and so on and so forth. And so it's not just the private sector. Famously, you had Chuck Brown of Citibank saying, we knew this was unsustainable, but when the music plays, you dance. A lot of people were making money in the private sector, and a lot of political capital was being gained in the public sector. You put the two together, everybody borrows and everybody helps fuel a boom. So that's kind of the background. And the question we then face is, how do you, in this environment where clearly the music did stop, and suddenly you went from an environment of borrowing and spending to the opposite, where everybody tries to rebuild net worth, the consumers and households save, companies sit on piles of cash because they don't have the confidence to invest. How, in that kind of environment, do you go ahead and finance innovation and growth and reform the dysfunctional system that got you here in the first place? And I think what came out of this discussion and the discussion in the morning was that you've got a mix of pull and push factors. You need what Carlotta describes as enabling policy to unleash the deployment of innovation. So you need a market, you need innovators and investors to feel enthused that there's something to invest for. It's not just a question of finance, of just pumping money into all this. I was talking to Jeff Mulgan last night, and I was saying, look, if I gave everybody in this room a tenner and said, look, you've got half an hour, go innovate, I don't think you'd come back with much. Some of the more kind of creative amongst you might have a few beers in the pub. But if I took all your mobile phones and your keys and threw them in the fire and then said you've got half an hour, go innovate, you'd come out with pretty clever ways of getting home and of breaking into your cars and all the rest of it. And that money, if I had to give you £10, would probably be put to good use. So you need a reason to innovate. And sometimes, in the climate context, for example, or the resource constraint context, it could be a negative reason, or it could be going to war, or it could be some cock-waving competition to get to the moon. Sometimes these constraints prompt innovation. But you do need capital. I think one of the themes that came out this morning was you don't just want casino capital, you want patient capital. But I thought Mauro touched very well on, patient capital is all very good, but the reciprocal of casino capital is prudent hedging. Diversification of risk. A lot of derivatives were invented actually to diversify risk. So how do you get that balance right? And how do you force society to be patient? Is it just a function of the financial system, or is it something rather broader than that? Does it come back to that rather lame quotation from Krugman about social norms? Can we do anything about social norms? What's the role of the state? What's the role of institutions? We had this fascinating discussion before this session on what the role of the press is. And what's the role of all the academics here in terms of getting the story out in a compelling and persuasive manner? And then, of course, there's real-world realities. We know about geodemographic trends. We know that automation through ICT and globalization mean that, the relative returns to skills are enormous, and that's widened the income gap in all countries. Thomas Friedman likes to say, if you're not skilled now, there's nothing below you. You used to be able to have a minimum expectation in the rich world. Now there's nothing, because your competition is in India and China, and they're much willing to take on much lower wages. And then he adds, it's not just low-wage competition, it's not just cheap labour, cheap goods, cheap services. Increasingly, India and China are presenting us with cheap genius. So even if you've got the skills and the university education, you shouldn't feel that secure. So how do you restore confidence in this environment, if you like, of entrenched vertigo, where we're all kind of looking down with very little in the way of a safety net below us? As I say, some of these threats could be a fantastic motivator, but without a belief in profitable markets, it's very unlikely you're going to get sufficient investment, sufficient innovation, and sufficient growth. So I'll just end with a quote from Carlotta, who'll be talking next, who I think really captures the essence of what I'd like everybody to think about and perhaps discuss. And she writes, "The real solution to the problems of growth, employment, and finance at the present turning point is to revive the production economy by radically reshaping market conditions in order to encourage innovation, investment, and employment creation with healthy profit prospects." How do we get from where we are now to healthy profit prospects? Because if you look at 10-year risk-free interest rates, if you look at the yield curve on US Treasury bills, they are negative for 20 years. Right? They're less than 2% expected inflation for 20 years. That's the risk-free yield. That cannot reflect the real return of capital. All it can reflect is the lack of confidence that we're facing. So how do we provide the long-run transformational investment that we need and the short-run recovery and confidence to get us out of the present mess? I think that's the quandary that that we all face.
Thank you very much. Okay, we've got about 20 minutes, I think, for questions. Maybe I could just open with one question. I think we're all interested. One of the things we're interested in is similarities and differences between the 2008-09 crisis and the 1929 crisis, which Mary was talking about. And I wonder if I could just ask Mary one question, and that is, do you think that in the 1929 case, that financial innovation, financial engineering, which is widely blamed for, at least as a contributor to the recent crisis, do you think that that was an element in the, you mentioned the creation of holding companies and M&A and so on. I just wondered whether you felt that financial sort of innovation of the kind we've seen in the last few years was also a factor in the 29 crisis, or perhaps it was not.
So yes, for certain. I think in many ways that's where I was trying to get to with the suggestion that this was not fundamentally driven by a technology mania, it was fundamentally a financial mania. So I think there's no question in my mind that financial speculation was really sort of overwhelmingly important in driving what happened in the 20s. On the other hand, I do think that if I look back to what happened in the 1920s in the United States, at least, I think that it begs the question of whether we can make these very clean distinctions between where speculation happens and where it doesn't happen. In the following sense, the discourse today has been very much focused on speculators as financiers. When I go back to my industries and I look at what happens, I also see industrialists as speculators. And so if I look at the car industry, for example, people like Willie Durant and John Willys were quite happy to take advantage of securities markets. And they saw them as being there to facilitate the building of empires that sometimes made industrial sense and sometimes did not make industrial sense. And so I think the idea that speculators are only to be found in one part of the economy is not really very tenable when at least I look at the industries and the case studies that I know, and I know less about the last 10 years, and so it's hard for me to say in that regard. But yes, and not only.
Thank you.
So, yes.
But if question mark more than a remark. I mean, that relates to Ron and also Dimitri's comments. Is really there a skill bias in technical change, inducing other things being equal, higher reward to the high IQ, high skilled people? Not sure, because there is a good part of the highly educated population that sees his relative income falling. I mean, think of scientists, physicists, high school teachers in general. I mean, scientists and learned people, with the exception of those that go in the crook set, going at Wall Street, they basically earn much less. So I think that a good deal of the explanation of the widening income gap and widening inequality might be found into different form of social organization, class struggle, and the loss of power of the unions, especially in the States, but all over, more than strictly technological reasons. Second remark, I mean, not an expert of privatization in Eastern Europe, but I seem to remember that, for example, the data by John Earl do not show that in general, privatization to foreign owners increases differential productivity so much. Not an expert, so I might be wrong there. Short remark that would require another conference. Globalization. Should we I think we should curb globalization and talk about protection, otherwise we will be unable to defend our system, our social system.
No, of course, we intellectuals are badly paid. But I still think it's... I mean, I organized a conference in 1985 on this question of whether or not... I mean, because the welfare minimum was rising and the actual market value of the wages of people who could learn to do nothing better than what almost anybody else could learn to do, whether or not we were entering a period of play a piano, if you know the Vonnegut novel, in which, or the Michael Young, you know, word of meritocracy. There is that element, of course, but it's certainly not measured by intellectual curiosity and intellectual achievement necessarily. But these, somebody was telling me yesterday about UBS and reeling off the number of smaller banks that it collected, and making the point that it was totally impossible for anybody on the boardroom to control these people, so it became an organization driven entirely by traders. And a lot of these traders are very smart people. And one of the, I mean, like the institutionalization of R&D by firms like General Electric and so on, was a real sort of step change in the development of innovation. So, in the same way, the invention of risk management models. Well, this is Gauss something or other, model, which was used for measuring risk in banks and so on. And the faith, you know, that you could take more and more risk, provided, you know, your tail end was this shape or that shape, that, if you like, that's a technological factor. And it did have a very big effect on the extent to which these people were taking the risk. But they were very clever people, you know.
Also, mafia chiefs are very clever.
Also?
Mafia chiefs are very clever. Okay.
Yeah, just to quickly address the privatization question. Research was done by my colleagues, but it was a survey paper which ended up in Journal of Economic Literature last year. So they have surveyed actually a large number of data and papers. And you're right that privatization did not improve efficiency much, but it kind of depends the way you do it. So if you do it mostly to foreigners and you sell them a large chunk of the company, so if it's concentrated, not necessarily a mass privatization, can be one by one, you know, selling a particular company, it does have positive effects. So this is just clarification of that.
Okay, Bill.
Yeah, for Barry, I know that chart put at the end, because I know you want to say that there in history, but you, it's fascinating.
On all those waves, the booms, or the speculations, Wall Street's there in the late 1890s with the merger movement. It's there in the 20s. It's there every time. So I think you already raised it a bit, saying, you know, who's on the other side of the market, for one thing, you know, in terms of who else has an interest in this. And I think that's a really fascinating research agenda, as well as what underlies the boom. So if you think of it, for one thing, in the late 20s, what you were saying about Walter Chrysler, you know, these companies, one, didn't have investor relations departments. They didn't have stock options for their executives. So their ability to influence this this kind of thing was very different. And of course, Durant, who built up General Motors, was a kind of speculator, not really a manager. So there's that issue. Then the other thing is, once you come to really recently, you know, the boom before the housing boom and bust, particularly in the United States, of course, Wall Street's there, securitization. But it seems like maybe this is the first time that you have this boom in the stock market. And, you know, as I showed in my, the S&P 500 is actually higher index in 2007 than it was in 2000. And it's not really industrial firms that are underlying this. It's basically getting poor people who can't afford homes to speculate, which is quite incredible. And it's, in some ways, you could say maybe, you know, Wall Street has run out of ways to try to grab money out of the economy. And you could also say that earlier on, even, you know, the department stores, the Safeways, and all those, they lasted a long time. So there could have even been a productive rationale for that. Anyway, so the question is there something where you could say over time, over a century, in fact, the whole thing starts getting more and more financialized until you actually have to just, you know, get poor people to speculate on their homes, and that becomes the basis of the bubble.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I didn't mean to imply, and I may have, is that in some sense these merger manias are the same thing over and over again. Because I actually think once you start realizing that that may be what's going on, what's striking is how different they are each time. And so if you think about from the point of view of the real economy, what's driving this kind of merger activity, if you go back to the late 19th century in the United States, it's really price competition and an attempt to control what people talked about as excess price competition in what's essentially a long depression. In the 20s, it's about building national networks out of, you know, still largely regional companies in some cases, and even local companies in the case of banking. In the 60s, it's something totally different. It's diversification, it's conglomeration, it's all of that. And in the 1990s, it's different again. So I think that from the point of view of the real economy, what mergers mean are very different in these different waves. And then, as you suggest, the facilitating factors in the financial sector are profoundly different. And so in no sense do I mean to imply that the financial sector we had in the 1920s is what we have today. I mean, that looks pretty good compared to what we have now. I mean, can we go back to that one instead? So I think that the degree to which the economy, with finance, has penetrated all parts of the economy, there's no parallel with that, I think. If you think about households, if you think, yeah, we had consumer debt back then, but it's really just the beginning. Your mortgages are still, 3 to 4 year propositions in the late 1920s. So I'm not suggesting that this is a repetition, simply. Just that there are common elements, but in that sense, I'm a Schumpeterian. The economy is fundamentally being transformed. No moment in history is the same as one before, and so that's really.
Any other questions?
Well, thank you very much for all presentations. They were very fascinating. My name is Caetano Pena from University of Sussex. I have a question to Mary O'Sullivan. It seems to me that the fact that there was more than 75 IPOs in the period, it's quite relevant if you consider that maybe maximum 5 companies dominated the market share, and after the depression only less than 10 were left in the market. So it's quite similar, like only four General Motors and Chrysler survived the Great Depression or the war, and American Motors and others. So from a maximum, I think, of 300 car companies in the U.S., only 10 survived. So I think it's a sign of some kind of speculative bubble in a similar way that during the dot-com bubble, you have many IPOs also of companies that were worth nothing. So what do you think about
it? Yeah, I didn't really talk about that, but in actual fact, and other people before me have made this argument, the 1920s is actually not a period in which you have lots of initial public offerings. In fact, it's dominated by secondary securities issues, seasoned security issues by established companies, with a few exceptions. But automobiles is not one. So the IPO boom in that industry happens in 1915, not in the 1920s. And shakeout has already happened by World War I and is then just sort of decisive by the 1920s. But you're not shaking out an increasing population of firms. That's already happened. So where you see IPOs is in aviation, for example, most particularly. But what's interesting is aviation, you have a boom after Lindbergh crosses the Atlantic. There's a boom, and I can't remember how many companies are funded. Something like 60 companies are funded in the space of 4 months. And you can just imagine what happens to these companies if they were allowed to survive, but they weren't. So almost immediately after that happens, there's a massive merger boom in this industry, which creates companies that ultimately gave rise to companies that still exist today. But this was an attempt to build, by financiers and industrialists, to build the General Motors of aviation. That's the way they talked about it. Let's merge these things together to create giants who can negotiate with the American government, which was providing most of their contracts at that point to basically transport the U.S. mail. And this was a very deliberate attempt to build up four dominant companies, which were in place by 1930. So this is not a period, and in that sense, it's different from today's market, or the market we saw in the 90s at least. This is not a period of an IPO boom as such. In fact, I would argue that the first really serious IPO boom occurs in the late 1950s and early 1960s after Sputnik. And that's a hint, because it's related to defense funding, it's related to all of those things, and it's in emergent electronic stocks, essentially. And that's really the first, I think, what you would call an IPO boom as such. The term IPO is not even used in the 20s, or anything similar to it.
You mentioned globalization, which I think you said
quick note on globalization. I mean, one has to be careful on the point you made about globalization. I mean, it's disconcerting for us to know that there's this competition, but if you're Indian or Chinese, it's a fantastic thing, and the degree to which hundreds of millions, perhaps billions of people are being lifted out of poverty as a result of the opportunity to sell into our markets at a more cost-effective manner than us is, I think, a very positive thing. So one has to be very careful before one prescribes border tariffs and the risks of trade wars and closing markets. There are two ways you can be competitive in terms of relative unit labour costs. Unit labour costs are just average earnings or wages over productivity. You can either raise wages, or you can lower wages, or you can raise productivity, and I would suggest that the latter might be the cleverer way to go if you're trying to induce innovation as well. So becoming competitive is not just it's a unit costing, crucial term there, unit of output is the denominator rather than just a costing.
Okay. One more point.
I just wanted to ask about this issue that came up about what governments should do if they know that there is an unsustainable boom going on in the private sector, because there are people who now seem to argue that Gordon Brown and his predecessors should actually have run a surplus in the 2000s to build up enough capital to rescue the banks when the banks inevitably collapse. It's a wonderful bit of sort of hindsight. But it does seem in practice, when governments are running surpluses, there is overwhelming pressure either to get rid of the surplus through tax cuts, give it back to the private sector, or just to pay off debt. They can't sort of set it aside as a contingency fund to deal with the private sector when it implodes. Is there anything that can be done about that? Or are we in a situation where really governments only ever run deficits, aren't allowed to run surpluses?
Can I say something on the...
It's the next research project. But I think that this is the Chinese industrialization is the only example in history of a continent that is export-led, that has an export-led growth. All other episodes of industrialization were mainly inward-oriented. Look at the United States, they never exceeded 7% of export over GDP, but they were lower. It is true that the Chinese wage increased, but also Chinese productivity increased. This is the only episode of industrialization in which very early on the share of wages has remained, has flattened out. Generate goes up. Now, do you think that the Chinese worker or capitalist are going to pay your pension? I don't think so. And if you want our pension to be paid and our welfare system to be safe, I cannot think of any other way other than some protection of, for example, Europe or the United States or whatever. Together.
I think on that note, we should start on to the next session. Could I ask you to express your thanks?